and wisdom. Our God is an awesome God. Ooh, our God is an awesome God. Ooh, our God is an awesome God. God is an awesome God. Our God is awesome. He reigns from heaven with power and wisdom. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is awesome. He reigns from heaven with power and wisdom. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Ooh. Our God is an awesome God.
Our God is an awesome God.
Our God is awesome.
He reigns from heaven
with power and wisdom. An awesome God.
Our God
is awesome. He reigns from heaven
with
power and wisdom. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Our God is an awesome God.
He reigns from heaven with wisdom, power, and wisdom. Our God is an awesome God.
Family members, we would love to talk with you about Twickenham, our history, what we think God is doing here, and how you could be a part of that. We'd love to have that conversation with you. In fact, a couple of folks have indicated they want to make Twickenham their home. We welcomed one last week, and this morning, Peggy Walker, are you in the house, Peggy? Are you there? Peggy, stand up and wave. Let everybody see who you are. Welcome to Peggy. Glad to have her. And then I don't know if are Brandon and Lauren here? Brandon and Lauren Howard, are you guys here? I'm thinking they may not be. She is about to have babies, twins. And so, come on, step up and come to church after. Yeah. Brandon and Lauren Howard, they already have Auden and Claire and McKenna are on the way, so we'll introduce them maybe to you next week, or well, I think she's actually due next week, so you'll meet them one day, all right? So certainly when we pray for the babies, but glad to have those folks, and again, if you're looking for a church home, we'd love to have you. We are always trying to provide you with some resources to help you navigate through the culture with a strong faith, and a guy down in Montgomery named David Platt is a good resource for a lot of folks. There's a video we want to show you about an upcoming event called Secret Church. Watch this video, and then I'll be back up in just a second.
It seems like a lot of people in the world have the idea that with so many different religions in the world, all claiming to have some truth, that all religions are fundamentally the same and just superficially different. There's different ways to serve the same God or gods or whatever you want to call God or gods. It's almost like there's a mountain theory of religions that you may take this path up the mountain and I may take this path, but at the end we're all going to be in the same place. So is that true? Or is it false? Is there one way amidst all of these different ways? In the next Secret Church, we're going to be diving into a global gospel and a world of religions. We're going to put the truth of the gospel and the teachings of Christ up next to all the major religions of the world. And we're going to see if there are actually fundamental differences, and if there are, how those differences affect not just what we believe, but how we live. So I hope that you'll be a part of the next Secret Church on April 29th, 2016.
Be a simulcast that we will be hosting here at our building. So if you want to be involved in that, give us a call at the church office. Let Steve Krieger know. We'll get you signed up for it. This morning, our worship is going to be guided by a prayer the Apostle Paul prays in Ephesians chapter 3. Very powerful prayer that he prays over the church. In fact, you're going to hear that prayer prayed over us three times this morning throughout our time of worship together. So let's stand, and I want you to hear a passage from the book of Colossians that talks about where that kind of where the power really comes from and where it's invested. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the powerful name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to the God the Father through him. Let's praise the Lord through the powerful name of Jesus.
All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all.
There is strength in the name of the Lord.
God and Father, you are the God and Father of every tribe and language and people and nation, and you have chosen to display your wisdom and reveal your truth through the church. We are not able to fulfill that mission on our own, so we pray that out of your glorious riches you may strengthen us with power through your Spirit in our inner being, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. We pray that we, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all your holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that we may be fulfilled in the measure of all of the fullness of God. Now to you who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to your power that is at work within us, to you be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Let the earth and heavens rejoice,
for the Lord our God reigns. Every child of God lift your voice, for the Lord our God reigns. Jesus Emmanuel, he has set us free. Hopeless souls redeemed to tell, for the Lord our God reigns. For the Lord our God reigns. Every heart be filled with his light, for the Lord our God reigns. All the hopeless dance with delight, for the Lord our God reigns. Jesus Emmanuel, he has set us free. Hopeless souls redeemed to tell, for the Lord our God reigns. For the Lord our God reigns. Jesus Emmanuel, he has set us free. Hopeless souls redeemed to tell, for the Lord our God reigns. For the Lord our God reigns. For the Lord, for the Lord, for the Lord our God reigns.
Think about his love.
Think about his goodness. Think about his grace that's brought us through. His goodness, think about his grace that's brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love. Great is the measure of our Father's love. My desires. Think about his love. Think about his goodness. Think about his grace that's brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love. Great is the measure of our Father's love.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong, a perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hand.
My simple soul is counted free, for God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me, to look on him and pardon me.
Behold him
there, the risen Lamb, my perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood, my life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my
Don't we all love a mystery? Think a moment of a mystery in your life. Let me help you out. Loch Ness Monster. UFO crash in Roswell, 1947. Bermuda Triangle, or Bigfoot. Now we all know Bigfoot hadn't been found because he has a TV show every week and they're still looking for him. I always ask my son, Ryan, every week, hey, is this the show where they find him? He's like, no, Dad. Okay, maybe that's next week. But there are other mysteries that are a little deeper. Atlantis, the city written about by Plato 2,500 years ago. Fact, fiction, or allegory? Easter Island, the statues of the Moai, 900 of them. The largest, 32 feet tall, weighing 82 tons. Why? Stonehenge in Salisbury, England. The blocks, 30 feet tall, that weigh 25 tons. And of recent, they have found 17 previously unknown artifacts and monuments beneath Stonehenge in England, currently, right now. The very first exomoon has been found. An exomoon is a moon that orbits a planet that is not in our solar system. First one. But they're not really sure if it's a moon or another planet, with all due respect to Pluto. So they're just not sure. It's a mystery. 2,000 years ago, the Apostle Paul wrote about a mystery. This mystery is in Romans 16, verse 25. Please take a moment to hear this. Now to him who is able to establish by you my gospel and the proclamation of Christ Jesus according to the revelation of the mystery hidden for long ages past. What mystery? What mystery is the most prolific writer of the New Testament who wrote 13 out of 27 books? What's he talking about? Well, flip over to Colossians 1:25. And listen to this, please. Colossians 1:25. I have become its servant by the commission God gave me to present to you the word of God in its fullness, the mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the saints. To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory, the greatest mystery known to mankind. is that the God of the universe, who through all things were created and through whom all things hold together, came to this earth in the form of a man. The mystery of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in us. Ephesians says, I want you to know, Paul's writing, how wide, how long, how deep, how high is this mystery? Well, this is exactly how wide, how long, how high, and how deep. Please hear this. Romans 5:8. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. 1 Corinthians 5:21. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, that we might become his righteousness. Philippians 2:8-9. He humbled himself by being obedient to death, even death on a cross. For just a few moments this morning, please move everything out of your mind. And let's offer our silence before the King of Kings. Because of this ceremony that we are about to partake in, that is recorded in four places in the Bible, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and 1 Corinthians, in Jesus' own words, he established this ceremony. Take a moment to know that you stand before God, righteous, pure, blameless, spotless, and perfect, because Jesus shed his blood for you. For the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread or drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Would you please pray with me? Father God, we pray over the bread. We pray over your broken body that was shed for our sins, that the God of the universe would come and indwell our hearts, that mystery has been solved. The mystery has been revealed in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Please bless this bread as we take it in this memorial to remember our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And through him we pray, amen.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you, where your love ran red and my sin washed white. I owe all to you. I owe all to you, Jesus.
And after the bread, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." We are no longer under the Mosaic law of sin and death, but the new covenant of Christ and eternal salvation. Would you please pray with me? Father God, we take this cup. We ask you to bless this cup to remind us of your blood that established a brand new covenant, the covenant with you, of forgiveness, of righteousness, of purity and spotlessness, and eternal salvation with you, your Father, and the Holy Spirit for all eternity. It is through you we humbly pray this blessing over the cup. In Jesus' name, amen.
There's a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever found comes like flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you, where your love ran red and my sin washed white. I owe all to you. I owe at the cross.
Praise him, you heavens and all that's above.
Praise him, you angels and heavenly hosts. Let the whole earth praise him. Praise him, the sun, moon, and bright shining stars. Praise him, you heavens and waters and skies. Let the whole earth praise him. Great in power, great in glory, great in mercy, King of heaven, great in battle, great in wonder, great in Zion, King over all the earth. Praise him, you heavens and all that's above. Praise him, you angels and heavenly hosts.
Father of every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have chosen to display your wisdom and reveal your truth through the church. We are not able to fulfill that mission on our own. So we pray that out of your glorious riches, you may strengthen us with power through your Spirit in our inner being, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. We pray that we, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all your holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that we may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to you who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to your power that is at work within us, to you be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, John. That prayer that you've heard now twice is in Ephesians chapter 3, beginning in verse 14, and we're going to look at that in just a second. So you're going to be turning over there, Ephesians chapter 3. I wanted to remind you that last week I introduced you to this book that we've purchased, one for every family here at Twickenham. There's a table out here to my right, to your left as you exit out this door. You can pick up one of these if you haven't gotten one yet. If you're a guest this morning, we'd welcome you to take one as well. It's a book by Tom Rainer called I Am a Church Member. And the focus of this book is to basically say we're not just attenders to an event on Sunday mornings. We are members of a body. participants in a mission. We have a job to do that's a 7-day-a-week, 24-hour-a-day job. And it's a call to raise our level of commitment in every way so that we can be who God calls us to be as the church. Not this building, not this time of week, but this people. It's a challenge to fulfill that mission. So urging you to pick this up, read it, and take the pledges, and let's see what God can do when we give Him our lives and make our commitments to be who He calls us to be as the church. Pick one of these up in the lobby over here. Part of our church back in Atlanta was made up of folks from Korea. Baby, did I put my glasses over there? No, they're in my pocket. Never mind. That's my wife that I was calling baby. Okay. So, you know, Larry thought it was him, but it's not. So, love you, but not that much. So, part of our church back in Atlanta was made up of folks from Korea. They had their own worship service. They had their culturally appropriate ways of being the church for them as they reached out there to their community. They even had their own minister, sweet guy named Songwoo, and he at one point brought his parents over from South Korea, brought them over to live with him in the United States. They were getting a little older, frail in their health. His dad had a heart condition. They were actually getting a lot older. They were pretty old folks, and didn't speak a word of English, not a single word. But they maintained as many of their cultural routines as possible. And one of those cultural routines was that early in the morning, every day, every single day, early in the morning, and I mean 4:30 a.m., 5 a.m., they would come to the church building, and we gave them a key. They would come to the church building to pray. They just felt like that's where they needed to be to start their day. And so they would come in, usually just in the dark, and one of them would sit, his mother would sit over here, and his father would sit somewhere over here, and they would just pray out loud in separate parts of the auditorium. One Monday morning, I got to the office really early and went up to my office to get to work, and then I realized, wait a minute, I left my Bible on the pulpit. So I went downstairs to get it, and it was dark outside still, and it was dark in the auditorium, but I knew it, so I didn't bother to turn the lights on. I just walked down there to get it. And it turns out we had one of those kind of big boxy pulpits that had a shelf on it. My Bible wasn't on top. Somebody had put it down on the bottom. So I was down here feeling for my Bible, and you couldn't see, okay? This is all wood. I was feeling for my Bible when I heard voices in Korean. And they were out there praying. And so I'm down behind the lectern, and I'm going, okay, they're oblivious to my presence. They have no idea I'm in here. They're both hard of hearing. They're in there praying in a dark room in a new country. And for all I knew, one of them had just said, Lord, speak to me. And if I had spoken to them, one of them was going to go meet Jesus right then. And I thought that'd be real inappropriate. So, I mean, it's a really awkward situation. So I just stayed down behind the pulpit. And I learned two things. One is elderly Korean Christians pray a long time. I mean, they talk to the Lord. They do. And the other thing I learned was that you don't have to understand everything somebody is saying to know that they are having a moment with the Lord, and that what they are saying is important and emotional and sacred. This prayer that we're going to look at today in Ephesians chapter 3 is a little like that moment that I had with Songwoo's mom and dad. It's a prayer, just like theirs was. Parts of it are hard to understand. They just are. But the whole thing feels very holy, very sacred. You've already heard it a couple of times. I want us to hear it again, this time for the purpose of studying the prayer. And then I'm going to give you two or three observations, just sort of generally, and then we'll look at the three things Paul prays for, okay? Let's hear the prayer from Ephesians chapter 3, beginning in verse 14. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. All right, here's where the prayer starts. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Okay, two or three general observations here just about this prayer before we get into the details. First, Paul, you need to know that Paul is praying for the group, not individual Christians. All the pronouns that you heard, except for one, are plural pronouns. If we were translating this from its original language into Southern English, we would use the word y'all a lot, okay? It's all plural. That may not seem like a big deal. It's a distinction maybe without a difference as far as you're concerned, but it has huge implications for how we interpret the prayer, and especially how we appropriate the prayer, because you get down there at the end where it says he's able to do immeasurably more than you ask or imagine. He's not saying that if you ask God for a bass boat, he's going to give you a cabin cruiser, okay? That's not what he's saying, all right? Second thing, it's worth noting, once again, that Paul brings all three persons of the Trinity into the conversation. He talks about God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. That's significant because one of the things the prayer emphasizes is the sense of community that should be a part of who we are, a part of our identity in Christ, because we come from a God who lives in community with the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. Therefore, we are called to live in community. And you got to know that is not always easy, living in community. Sally Brown is a professor of theology at Lutheran Seminary. She says that Christians are, I want to be sure I get the quote right, Christians are blessed with each other and stuck with each other. We just are. You have a relationship with God, that means that you're tangled up with God's people, and it's not always easy, but the emphasis on community in this prayer is significant. Okay, one more general observation, and this is about how the prayer ends in verse 21. This struck me really tough this week, not in a bad kind of way, in just an overwhelmingly grateful kind of way. Verse 21, Paul prays that God will be glorified in the church throughout all generations. He prayed that 2,000 years ago, and here we are today, glorifying God in our Sunday worship, even as this church tries by God in our daily living, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, at work, at school, in our homes, in our neighborhoods. This prayer has been handed down from one generation to the next. And we're the most recent recipients. But we're more than that. We're beneficiaries of the people who came before us, who handed the faith down and have preserved this prayer and kept handing it down through the generations. I just want to say to our oldest members here, thank you for passing the faith down. Thank you for passing down to us the commitment and the work and the sacrifices you made, because we're beneficiaries of that, and the people before you passed it on to you, and the people before them passed it on to them. And all of that tells me that the church needs to be grateful for the people who've done work in the past, but always looking in the future. We got to always be thinking about the future, because our job is to pass this down to our children and our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren. We got to keep that moving. And we've got to do whatever it's going to take and spend whatever it's going to cost to be sure that message, this prayer, gets passed down so that it will, Jesus will continue to be glorified generation after generation. I just think that's a call that this prayer makes to us. Okay, the fact that Paul prays for the church is not unusual, but it is important. In virtually every letter he writes to a church, he tells them that he is praying for them. For example, Romans chapter 1, he says to the Romans, I constantly remember you in my prayers. He says to the Corinthians, I always thank my God for you. In 2 Corinthians, our prayer is that you may be fully restored. He wasn't quite as happy with them in the second letter. Philippians, in all my prayers for you, I always pray with joy. He even prayed for churches that he had never visited. He never, as far as we know, never visited the church in Colossae, but he says, we have not stopped praying for you. It is the same thing with the Thessalonians. He says, we continually remember you in our prayers. Just the fact that Paul prays for the churches is instructive. Because if all there was to church was showing up on Sunday morning and singing a few songs and hearing a sermon and passing the plates, we wouldn't need prayer. That's all there was to it. We wouldn't really need any prayer. We'd need a calendar, an alarm clock, and maybe a cup of coffee. But beyond that, we could get by fine just by meeting here. We wouldn't need to pray. So apparently, there's a lot more to church than just showing up on Sunday. For Paul, there's far more to church. And whatever it is, it requires enormous amounts of prayer, which becomes obvious immediately, because the first thing he does in verse 14 is tell us why he prays. For this reason, I kneel before the Father. What reason is that? Well, it's what we talked about last week when we looked at the first half of chapter 3. God's plan from the beginning, from before the beginning, before the creation of the world, was that he would display his wisdom and communicate the meaning of the cross of Jesus to the world through the church. This collection of people, full of men and women who all come with our own unique kinds of brokenness and imperfection, this collection of people from every race and ethnicity and nation and tribe under heaven, this is God's plan to communicate the message of the cross to the world. Sounds crazy, right? I mean, just look around you for just a second. Just look to your left, look to your right, look up in the balcony. God's plan for addressing the problems of the world is sitting in the seats to your left and your right, in front of you and behind you. God's plan for addressing the problems of the world is sitting in your seat. Is there tension between the races? The church is supposed to address that. Is there confusion in our culture about gender and sex? The church is supposed to respond to that. Are nations and factions at war? The church knows the Prince of Peace. Are people stuck in generational poverty? The church is called to deliver. Are people deceived and confused by empty philosophies and false religions? The church knows Jesus, the way, the truth, the life. No wonder Paul prays. We have an enormous mission that can only be accomplished by the power of God. And I'll say this, there are voices in our culture that want to say to us, you Christians, get together on Sunday and do your little church thing in your building and you just be quiet. Okay, we don't want to hear you. We don't want to hear your intolerance. We don't want to hear from you. You can go do your thing in your church, but we don't want to hear your voice in the public square. That's not how it works. That's not who we're called to be. God's plan from before the creation of the world was that His message was going to be communicated to the world through the church. That means we have a conversation that we need to have with the world. And it can't be just in here on Sunday, because this is not what church is. This is when the church meets. This is what we do on Sunday morning. But the rest of the week, we have to be engaged. So Paul prays. That's how big the mission is, and so he prays. His prayer is addressed, he says, to the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. The idea is that God is the Father of all families, clans, tribes, nations. We're all sons and daughters of the same Father, no matter the color of our skin or the shape of our eyes or the language of our tongues. That's why he prays, and that's who he prays to. So what specifically does Paul ask? Three things. The first one is in verses 16 and 17. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. He prays for power. The ability to accomplish things. The capacity to control your life. Would you like some power? Wouldn't it be awesome to have power? Plato said that power was the absolute mark of being. If you don't have power, you can't be human. Powerlessness was next to non-existence. A lot of the religious activity in first century Greek and Roman culture was an effort to harness the power that existed in the cosmos through magic formula and incantation and various religious activities. But you know, you don't really need a philosopher like Plato to tell you that power is attractive. Ask any parent of a two-year-old, and they will tell you that from a very young age, human beings crave power. And we get our first taste of it when we learn how much power is contained in that little two-letter word, no. And from there is no end to the creative ways we try to get power and keep power. And so Paul is praying about a very personal thing here when he prays about power, but it's a dangerous thing. There's not much room between having the power to control your own life and wanting to use power to control the lives of others. Most of the problems in our world, most of the problems in our marriages and families, most of the problems in our church spring from struggles to get or take or keep or use power. So Paul prays for a very specific application of power. He knows it's dangerous. He prays that we'll have the power that Christ can dwell in our hearts through faith. He's praying that we will have a strong and powerful trust in God. That's what faith is, trust in God. I don't want to let you down. I don't want to burst your bubble. I don't want to disappoint you, but Paul is not praying, and this prayer may not be appropriated, so that you will become a fully self-determining individual with the resources to control your life any way you see fit. There's too much of that going around anyway. He's not praying that you will become master and commander of your own life. He's praying that you and I will have a faith that trusts in God because of what He has done through Jesus Christ. The only reason the power of God is involved in this process is because having that kind of faith requires submission, and submission is not a move that comes naturally to people who love power. It takes the power of God for us to submit our will to His. On the corporate level, He is not praying that Twickenham will become a popular church. He's not praying that we will become an influential church. He's not praying that we will become a powerful church in Huntsville, Alabama, or in the state, or in the southeast, or in the country, or even in the world. He is praying that we will be a church with a strong faith, that we will trust in God so strongly, so deeply, that we'll do whatever He asks, we'll give whatever it takes, and we'll leave the popularity and the power to Him. Paul is praying first that God will give us a strong, strong faith. Second, verses 17 and 19, he says, I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge. There's that word power again. This time, it's not the power to trust, it's the power to grasp. The word conjures up the idea of aggressively seizing something, appropriating it in a forceful manner. It describes the power of a strong grip. I knew an elder once back in Atlanta who used to shake your hand, and when he shook it, his hands were huge, and when he got through shaking, you'd have imprint of his hand on your... I had bruises more than once, because you preachers, you don't like to work, so he would squeeze my hand really hard, and it would hurt. That's what that word describes, a really strong grip. And the thing Paul prays that we will grasp is the love of Christ, the love that Christ has for us. So why would we need the power of God to comprehend the love of Christ? Because of what he says in verse 19. It's a love that surpasses knowledge. I want you to underline that, especially us in this town. I want us to underline that phrase. It is a love that surpasses your ability to know it. It's over your head. That's a hard thing for citizens in Huntsville to hear, because this town was built on knowledge. Paul is telling all of us rocket scientists and engineers and attorneys and theologians and educators and accountants that this is beyond you. You're smart, but you can't get this. It's so far past you. Still, I think some of us think we know the limits of Christ's love. We think we found the limit of Christ's love, but it's not because we're smart, it's because we're bad. Some of us in this room right now think that we ventured past the reach of Christ's love. Listen to Paul's prayer. I pray that you may have power to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. Some of us think that because we've committed the same sin so many times, that particular, you know the one I'm talking about? The sin that just has your number? The one that gets to you every time? Some of us think because we've committed that sin over and over and over that we are beyond Christ's ability to embrace us, forgive us, restore us, and love us. I want you to listen to what Paul prays. I pray that you may have the power to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. Some of us in this room think we have hurt too many people, caused too much damage, that we have left too much relational flotsam and jetsam in our wake, that there is no way Christ can restore us. I pray that you may have the power to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. You don't know the limit, no matter how bad you think you've been. The love that Jesus has for us is deeper than the deepest part of the ocean. If we jump in, we will never touch the bottom with our feet. The love that Jesus has for us is higher than the highest heaven. The space probe Voyager 1 was launched from Cape Canaveral on September 5th, 1977, almost 40 years ago. Currently, it's 12 billion miles from the sun. That's the last star it encountered. The next star it will encounter will be in 40,000 years. Voyager has not yet reached the limits of Christ's love for us. That's why we need the power of God to comprehend the love of Christ. It's huge. Now, we can experience that in little ways here and now. Paul gives us a clue. He says, I pray that you may have power together with all the Lord's holy people. We experience that love of Christ when we love each other. I mediate that love to you. You mediate that love to me. And here's a little secret. The more different we are from each other, the more different we are in terms of our sex or our race or our ethnicity or how we're made or our backgrounds, the more different we are from each other, the more powerful that love is. Because when people who are so different from each other love each other because of what Jesus has done, it's huge. Makes such a powerful statement. Makes that love feel so much more powerful. Okay, Paul prays for one more thing. Verse 19. I pray too that you will know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. I read a bunch of commentaries. I talked to some smart people. I even went online to try and find out what that means. Filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Few folks think they know. I got to tell you, nothing I read seems sufficient to unpack what being filled to the measure of all the fullness of God means. So I'll tell you what I think, and it's not even close. But here's what I think it means. If you have ever felt so steeped in sin, so thoroughly corrupt and failed and flawed and broken and unworthy and worthless that you couldn't tell where you stopped and the sin started, like you had become one with your sin. If you've ever felt like shame stuck to you like tar, and that every time somebody looked at you funny, they were thinking something awful about you, like they saw right through you. If you've ever just felt totally ruined and unrecoverable, being filled with all the fullness of God is the opposite of that. And Paul prays that you and I will experience that like he believes it's possible. He prays like he thinks it's possible. In fact, he closes his prayer with one of the most amazing affirmations in Scripture. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that it has worked within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. So what do we do with that? How do we respond to that? I think a good response is just to stand up and praise him. Let's stand. Let's sing.
Heavens and all that's above. Praise him, you angels and heavenly hosts. Let the whole earth praise him. Praise him, the sun, moon, and bright shining stars. Praise him, you heavens and waters and skies. Let the Great in power, great in glory.
real quick, just one thing before we close. Today is a very special one-year anniversary. Anybody know what that would be? Here, 1 year ago this week. And I don't know if you know this, Jody is not very good with names. In fact, he's terrible. After a year, he still doesn't know most of you. Not because he's not caring or doesn't want to, but there's a synapse that's bad in his brain and names doesn't work. He still calls Steve Scott about half the time, and he works with him every day, so it's really, really bad. Anyway, we wanted to do something to commemorate, just something a little sentimental, and just to kind of drive home 1 year, something that you could remember and have. And so we went to the church, and we garnered their support, and they lovingly, just from their hearts, gave back some unused copies of church directories that you could put in your cars and all the rooms of your house so that you can always study and remember all these lovely faces and their names.
Walton.
Thanks, Bob.
Before we pray, Sundays are special all over the world because we gather and we worship God, give Him thanks. But as Lincoln has said, this is, for this church, this is a very special morning. A year ago, we challenged Jody to preach the gospel. You have preached the gospel. You have preached the gospel. God has gifted you to preach. He's gifted you to write. Many of you who follow Jody's blog know that he is gifted to communicate to God's people. He's gifted with the joy of the Lord, with a heart for people. He's also gifted. This is going to be amplified, Lisa. He's gifted with a good, godly wife who has been everywhere and has done everything in this church, a humble heart. This couple is a gift to God, gift to us from God. And we worship God. We worship Jesus Christ. But with all of my heart, I know that God has given us this couple, and I praise Him for it, and I'm so glad you're here, Jody. In fact, I'm going to give him another round of applause. And now this prayer from Paul, Ephesians 3. You are the God and Father of every tribe and language and people and nation. You have chosen to display your wisdom and reveal your truth through the church. We are not able to fulfill that mission on our own. So we pray that out of your glorious riches, you may strengthen us with power through your Spirit and in our inner being, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. We pray that we, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all your holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that we may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now, to you who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to your power that is at work within us, to you be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.